Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Kyung-ho Park, Head of Environmental Markets, and I have the pleasure of moderating today's conversation with Martin Wolf, who is the Chief Economics Commentator at FT. You studied initially classics at Oxford, but then you ultimately graduated with a Master of Philosophy in Economics, and then you spent your early days at the World Bank, quickly becoming a senior economist. Help us understand what really brought you to economics, and how did the World Bank shape your initial views?
I went to find out at the World Bank whether I could make a difference to the world. At that stage, I was persuaded, as I think many young people were, interesting in light of history, young people of my kind, I was only 25, that development was the great challenge of the world, that development was the biggest moral issue and the biggest issue for economists.
At that time, with all the recovery needs,
remember the additional point that at that point, which is again unimaginable, the World Bank was development finance. There was no private finance. There were a few regional development banks that had almost no resources. So the World Bank under McNamara, he was there, of course, to purge his Vietnam-era guilt, was the show. And a lot of exceptionally talented people went there. Actually, my second mission was to Korea, and in 72. And actually, I learned an immense amount at the World Bank. I made some wonderful friends, many of whom went on to be very senior officials in important countries. And I learned some very important positive things and some very important negative things. And I never regretted this at all. But one of the things I learned is that I really wasn't cut out to be a bureaucrat.
But your experience at the World Bank did shape your views on markets and economics. And I want to understand a bit more about also how various influences in the world, including our most recent, you know, some of the global financial crisis and challenges, have shaped your views. But yet, at the core of your values, you're fundamentally unaltered in terms of really believing in liberal democracy. And I want to explore a little bit about that and your heritage.
I was a person who grew up in the Cold War. I was born in 46. And so the Cold War was the dominant experience of my life. And this was a fundamental ideological conflict, as well as being many other things, about what is a good society. And what may be difficult to imagine is that in the 50s and 60s, a very large number of people in the West thought the Soviets were sort of, if not right, were not far from right. And it worked. And that followed, of course, the Nazi era, the fascist era, which was ended in the Second World War. Now, the Nazi era was for me very directly and personally relevant because my parents were both refugees. My father came from Vienna, my mother came from Holland. Their wider families, not their immediate families, their wider families, in my mother's case, about 40 relatives, aunts, cousins and uncles, aunts and cousins and uncles, my father probably 20, they were all exterminated. So politics is pretty personal once that happens. Though my parents survived by a miracle in various ways. So if you like, for my family, the issue of totalitarianism, fascism, communism, is very personal and very real, and it is for me. But the feeling was you have to decide which side you're on. And it was very, very clear to us and passionately clear to my father, whom I greatly admired and was incomparably the greatest influence upon me in my life, that you had to decide which side he was on. And he, unlike many Central European intellectuals, was always passionately anti-communist, many weren't. And the side you had to be was on freedom and democracy. Those were the system that guaranteed individuals the largest possible self-expression, the largest possibility of acting collectively in a voluntary way. And that was the system you had to believe in. And I've never changed to the tiniest degree my adherence to this principle and will continue these beliefs and will continue to do so to the end.
So you joined the Financial Times now some 30 years ago, and you've been writing widely lauded commentary ever since. And in fact, the prior U.S. Secretary, Treasury Secretary Larry Summers, described you as the world's preeminent financial journalist. Give us some insight into how you pick your topics. And also, at least from my perspective, I'm not an economist, you seem to balance the analytics and the technical aspects with being able to provide such eloquent commentary that a layman like me can even understand and digest. How do you do that?
This in part goes back to my education, which I think considered was incredibly valuable, even though it meant that I'm a very low-level mathematician and could never be a proper technical economist. So the classics taught me to be rigorous. I mean, really rigorous. Every particle matters. And the doing PPE meant doing two essays a week. There's nothing like doing two essays a week and having it torn apart by a person more brilliant than you are, really quite literally, while you're sitting there after you've read it, to force you to think, have I actually explained myself properly? Mm-hmm. And those two things taught me how to be, I think, precise, fairly rigorous rigorous in a compressed way, and explain my ideas clearly, or at least that's what I hope I can do. And you can't do that if you haven't worked through yourself what you believe. Mm-hmm. You know, clarity only comes if you yourself are clear. Yep. And I think I have learned to be reasonably clear internally about what it is I'm trying to say. And once you're reasonably clear about what it is you're trying to say and you know what an argument looks like, this sort of thing just comes naturally. Mm. Now, in terms of topics, I tend to have the following approach to choosing topics, and there's something more specific. To write about something which is interesting, it has to be something which seems to me will be important to our readers, mm-hmm. which, even if they are not aware of it, potentially it's important to our readers. And second, on which I think I can add something to what's going around. I don't always manage that, I'm aware of that, but which I think I can add something quite often because I actually care about it. Mm-hmm.
You've written a lot about the global financial crisis. Mm-hmm. We're at the 10-year juncture, and you also did a book a few years ago around the lessons learned, right?
Or not.
So share with our audience your perspective on the global financial system, what's changed and what hasn't changed.
First of all, the global financial crisis was in its intensity, mm-hmm. To me, a surprising event. So I know a few people, and I respect them, I can list them, I know quite a few, who were closer to realizing that there was going to be a major turnaround than I did. I was quite aware there were lots of problems, but this event was far more intense than imagined. And more important than that, I think, this is maybe a slight exaggeration, it has transformed the world, and the transformation is still with us. It had a very profound effect on the economic performance and political stability of the Western world. There has to be, to make society work, and I think this is true whether an autocracy or a democracy, but it's even more important for a democracy since they rely on trust, a basic deal. The deal I think of as this. The people have a vote, which is good, but in terms of all the detail of policy, all the complexity of policy in the areas of health and economic regulation, and defense, the whole raft of it, they have to trust the elite. The elites, there are multiple elites, and I was like, to know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And they only realize when that trust is misplaced, from their point of view, if something obviously goes wrong, something big goes wrong, which they were never warned about and didn't expect. So the financial crisis is that big time. You've got all the economic policy makers, the politicians, and the financial sector itself, which is, to put it mildly, pretty well played, I would say exorbitantly so, and very, very powerful. And overnight, completely unexpectedly, the system blew up. It seemed to implode. Everything was in utter turmoil, and it was saved by the governments. As far as I can see, there is no event in British economic history since the Industrial Revolution, and I'm including two world wars here, which has had such long-run effects on economic prosperity. This is extraordinary. So you add these things together. This, of course, has devastated confidence and trust, and it has not been regained.
But also in an unequal recovery. People feel that they've lost their jobs, right, and haven't recovered from that, yet they're seeing others who are benefiting.
The trends for rising inequality of income and wealth clearly predate the crisis. Some would argue, and I have some sympathy with this view, that those, I have substantial sympathy with you, that some of those trends helped cause the crisis. There has been a general hollowing out of the middle, much more noticeable again in the US than elsewhere, but it's been true to some extent. Deindustrialization is another process that has continued now over 40 years. It has profound effects on the labor market, and particularly the labor market opportunities of a very important group politically, that is relatively unskilled men. But the point is those things were going on for a long time, and people were clearly getting more unhappy about this anyway. I think it's partly, you can see some of this, therefore, well before the crisis. The crisis exacerbated this because first, it was a great big recession and unemployment exploded, and lots of people lost their jobs, and lots of people coming into the labor market, famously, always happens, the young people entering the labor market, found their opportunities were very bad, and the general evidence we have is that the labour market is very bad when you're going to look for a job. It usually sticks with, on average, with people for much of their life. So they were badly affected. The unemployed were badly affected, and it jumped up to varying degrees. In some countries like Spain, it went through the roof. In the UK, it just went to 8%, just, and in America, with 10%. But still, that was a big shock. People were very frightened, and lots of people were driven out of the labor market. Labor force participation fell, particularly again in the US, interestingly, much less here. So there's some different stories. But the point is, lots of people had been doing badly for a long time. There was this huge shock, loss of confidence, a very slow recovery, and everybody was experienced the consequences of low productivity growth. And that had another consequence, fiscal austerity, because we were poorer. Tax revenue was worse, so everybody who benefited from government spending, that was clearly a very important part of the population, suffered. And the ordinary people say, but these people caused the crisis. What the hell is going on here? And so you get Donald Trump. So I think your story is right, but it's more complicated. So the question I have is, can we construct political economic systems that work well for our peoples now within the global economic context we have? And the difficulty, and this is the last point, and it's the core of it, is our economic system is by and large global. Our corporations look globally. Economic interchange is global. But political accountability, political legitimacy, political community, what makes people, ordinary people, feel who they are is national, sometimes subnational, as we can see in Spain, in Catalonia, or in Scotland. There is a profound conflict at the heart of the functioning of our economic and political systems. This is inherent in a global capitalist democratic order. I think we've got the balance between the two quite wrong. But it's not completely obvious how you get it right, because the tension is fundamental.
We are in an era of the need, arguably, for even more global cooperation, and you've kind of painted a dire picture. So coming back to a topic near and dear to my heart around climate change, where we need urgent, global, scalable action. I know you have a pretty pessimistic view on that, but what's your optimistic view in terms of how do we actually try to address a systemic issue that we need to collectively address in the context of where we are today?
Global cooperation, global governance, is more necessary now than ever before, because we've got a world in which human beings shape everything, what, as you will know, some call the Anthropocene.
Yeah.
And that's true, obviously, in climate, but it's true in other areas. You know, we have the capacity to devastate the world with nuclear weapons. We have all sorts of dangers and risks, which, by their nature, pandemics just zip across borders.
Yep.
So a world without the idea of a self and enclosed, autonomous, autarkic nation not engaged with the world is completely ludicrous. But what I'm saying is our politics are clearly becoming more local.
Yes.
When the global concerns are becoming more transcendent. How we resolve that, I don't know. It may be that at the end, the democratic principle will go. It's gone many times before, and we end up in more or less benevolent autocracies everywhere. Not what I want. But anyway, that's one possible outcome, the imperial outcome. In terms of the specific issue you mentioned, it is, of course, as Nick Stern has famously said, the biggest collective action problem in human history.
Right.
So it's global, it is complex, it involves some apparently visible costs, it is transgenerational, and who really cares about their great-great-grandchildren, or even their great-grandchildren? Fewer than what I would hope. And so it's an immeasurable problem. And then, of course, there are many technical aspects to it. So this is the biggest collective challenge humanity's ever faced. I believe passionately that we should tackle it. And I believe passionately in your proposition that the private sector should do what it can to help, though I don't think it can do it on its own.
No.
And
therefore, you've argued for things like carbon pricing
and
optimization. And
so the problem is, of course, that to get governments to agree on doing action which is early enough, obviously the earlier we act, the better, because it will get much more difficult to act later, decisive enough, that's very, very difficult. Technology seems to be helping us, so it's becoming easier to do. That's a big change. We're much more confident about the technology, as I read it. I'm not an expert here, of course, even to the slightest degree, than we would have been 15 years ago or 10 years ago. But the politics are clearly moving against us. My reading of it is if we continue as we are, we're not going to solve this problem. And it requires serious political commitment. Now, I'm very encouraged by the way the Chinese talk. I'm more impressed by them, at least in their intellectual grasp of the problem, than anyone else. But I think we would have to say at the moment, action has been far less in preface conversation. And remember, we first had a really serious summit on this in, was Rio? Was this 93?
A while ago,
So this is 25 years ago, and we really haven't done much. So I think being optimistic about it is irresponsible. Being realistic is responsible. And realism says something has to happen pretty fast to make a difference. And it's going to be far more difficult because of the free rider problem being so serious if one of the two great, most powerful countries in the world is simply not engaged in the effort. It would be very difficult if the US were engaged, and it's much more difficult now. So I'm afraid, in my view, this is not pessimism, it's realism. But most of the time, human beings tend to screw things up. Personal history and my age, you realize most of the time, not all the time, and we have some wonderful systems, science and technology is the greatest thing human beings have ever created. The scientific revolution is the most important single thing, I think even more important than the agricultural revolution, in transforming the world. And it just keeps going, and it's fantastic. But we have, of course, it's a system. But human beings have a terrible tendency to screw things up en masse, even individually.
I have a slightly more optimistic view on the fourth industrial revolution, which is about technology. There are social spillovers, as we talked about, but the incredible speed of innovation that is happening and the potential application to make things more efficient and smarter.
That is true.
On this,
that
so
is no
I'm a little bit more.
I'm professionally skeptical. I should be, and so I'm skeptical about the
hence
new tech,
so
the new technology stuff. But I recognize that some of what's been coming along is fantastically exciting and thrilling.
I want to thank you. You've been incredibly thought-provoking and insightful and candid and given us a lot to think about. So thank you for joining us today.
It was a great pleasure.